Well, I'll admit that when people ask me what I do, I really don't like to tell them because I'm afraid that they will go off about the new math. And it's not really a conversation that I want to have with a complete stranger in like 5 minutes because helping people understand why we teach math differently right now is such a deeper conversation. I'm Christina Tonneville, the Recovering Traditionalist, and today I'm going to attempt to explain in as short of a video as possible why math is taught differently now in our quest to build our math minds so we can build the math minds of our kiddos. Now, there's kind of some three main points that I want to hit with this. And you may not resonate with all of them, which is fine. That's why I'm going to share a few different perspectives on this. Okay. The first one I want to share with you is that testing data showed that the United States kids were behind. Like people say all the time that the way that I was taught math worked just fine, but did it really? When we were growing up, there wasn't the national and international testing like we have now and what happened a while back that really showed the comparison. Now, I am not a huge fan of testing data. There's a lot of issues with tests, but that is a world we are living in. When No Child Left Behind became federal law in 2002, data started coming in where we saw such varied testing results in the United States from state to state and even county to county. So even if you don't care about those test results, like I said, I really don't, it does help us see what's happening so that we can hopefully create a more equitable educational system. And one of the things that I found really interesting when a lot of this data started coming out in the 2000s, basically, everything was focused on data. And, take it as you will, but one of the things that I found really interesting was there was a study in 2009 that came out showing how kids were not ready for college level math. So, like, as a parent, that should be a big concern because at some institutions, like 90% of kids have to take remedial math courses that don't even count towards their degree. But yet, as parents, we have to pay for those courses. So they're coming out of high school, and we should think they're ready to go into college. But in mathematics, it was showing that kids were not ready, and they had to then take these courses that they had to pay for, but would not count towards their degree just to get them ready for the courses that would count for their degree, right? Now, I know that not every child goes to college. That is not for every kid. So it's not just about getting kids ready for college. It is also about helping ensure they are ready to go out into careers and just being good citizens. And that brings me to point number two, that this change in how we teach mathematics was from the new standards that came out. Now, Common Core State Standards kind of have a bad name. They came out in 2010, and people say all the time, "Oh, are you doing the Common Core math?" And I have good things and bad things to say about Common Core, but Common Core gave us two really good things that I find you can't really debate that. Maybe you can. Let me know in the comments. But the first thing is that it gave every child the same standards. When they started looking at the standards in the United States, every state had different standards. So if you were in fourth grade, the fourth grade math you did in North Carolina might be different than the fourth grade math standards that the kids in Mississippi were getting. So the level of the education, the standards that kids were being held to were so different from state to state. So the idea of these common standards was that these were the core standards that every fourth grader, every fifth grader, whatever grade would be held to, that there was this commonality that everybody was trying to reach at each grade level. Now, there's lots of good and bad about that, but the good thing for me was that everybody was kind of on the same playing field, basically. We were all trying to reach that same thing. And then now we can work together to talk about ways to make that actually happen. What's the best way to have that happen? The second thing that I loved about, and I still do love about Common Core, is the math standards of practice. So typically, standards are just the content, like students will be able to add and subtract numbers, right? That kind of a thing. But the standards of practice really tell us how kids will interact with the mathematics. It's things like how they engage with the math, like seeing mathematics in story problem format, encouraging kids to learn how to discuss strategies, to critique the reasoning of others. It's all of these things about how do we, like I said, engage and interact with the mathematics. It's not just sit down and get an answer. It is so much more than that. And the things that the standards of practice are helping build within our students are things that are what's known as survival skills. So Tony Wagner wrote a book called The Global Achievement Gap, and in it he outlined 7 survival skills that kids need to be able to kind of navigate the 21st century, whether it's going into college, getting a career, or just being a good citizen. Kids need these 7 survival skills. So I put them up on the screen here. These are the 7 things that he outlines in the book. It's not just about following rules and procedures, which is what mathematics really was all about. Now, we need to help kids be critical thinkers. They need to problem solve. They need to work together, learn how to work in a group, learn how to be a leader within that group. They need to be agile and be able to, you know, move from thing to thing and be adaptable, right? You can look through all of these things and I'll direct you. I'll put the link to the book down below this video, but all of these things are things that we can be helping build in our students through mathematics. Mathematics isn't just get an answer and be done with it. Yes, we do want kids to get correct answers. Correct answers is still important. That is not a part of new math. It's not just, oh, just do it whatever, and if you get a wrong answer, that's okay. No, we still want kids to get right answers, but how we get to those right answers is through creating problem solvers, critical thinkers, helping them build good communication skills. It isn't just sit down, follow these rules and procedures that I tell you to, okay? The third thing that I really love about why we are teaching math differently is that we are still focused on helping kids achieve. We do still want them to do well, perform well, get correct answers in mathematics, but we're doing it while also instilling a love of mathematics. Okay, so let's go back to the very beginning where I said that people say all the time, the way that math was taught to me worked just fine, right? So if you are of that mindset that you learned math just fine, right? I have a couple questions for you, a few questions. Number one, do you enjoy math? Do you look forward to doing a math problem? Do you find joy in doing math? Okay. Number two, did you make a career decision based upon the math classes or how much math you would have to do? And number three, don't you want better for the next generations, for your kids? Even if it worked fine for you and you did come out and everything's all hunky-dory, right? We always want better for our kids. So there are so many people, let's go back to that first one, right? There are so many people who not even don't enjoy math, they fear math. They don't want to do any math at all. Balancing a checkbook, anything like that, they will avoid. There is so much mathematics that happens in our daily lives that if you don't like math so much that you are avoiding it, it really does have an impact on you. You don't pay attention to how much tip you're doing or if people gave you the correct change back or all of those things that impact your wealth. You want to be able to pay attention, like interest rates, all of those kinds of things get impacted if you are paying attention to mathematics or you are avoiding mathematics. So we want people to at least not avoid it. I would love it if we can get to a point where we can truly enjoy math. Just like some people truly enjoy reading and can't wait to sit down with a book, I would love that for kids around mathematics, that as they grow older, they enjoy the challenge of a math problem, right? We want that for our future kids, for our future students and our own children as we go forward. Now, the second question I had for you was, did you make a career decision based upon mathematics? I know a lot of people who did. I know people who stopped pursuing a certain degree in school because there was too much math that they would have to do. I know someone who didn't even go to college and started a business on their own and then realized they hated running the books. They hated doing the books, the bookkeeping side of things. And so they shut down their business and then started, they still did the same thing, but for somebody else, right? So there are just so many decisions that people make that are impacted by whether or not they have to do mathematics. And like I said, that third one is we always want more doors to be open for kids than were open for us. And so if we can help them be able to learn mathematics still, to be proficient with mathematics, but to learn it in a way that helps open doors for them and that they become passionate about doing math and they enjoy math and they're not running from math, then that is a really, really good thing all the way around, right? You know, we do want kids to achieve better on tests, but we also want them to be problem solvers, critical thinkers, and not just answer getters, right? We want kids to enjoy mathematics and not to avoid it. Now, one of the first places that we can start to make a change in the way that kids see mathematics and the way that we teach mathematics is through how we help them become fluent with addition and multiplication facts, right? In the past, if you think about that, the way that you were taught to learn your addition and multiplication facts and even subtraction and division, it was just taught memorize, flashcards, drills, right? All of that. And we can do that. We can do that for our kids and they might be able to do it. But again, are we building that love of math? Are we building problem solvers? Are we building critical thinkers? We want kids to be fluent with their facts. But if you want to learn a way to do that, that's by helping kids become problem solvers, become critical thinkers, to look at numbers differently and see number relationships, not just facts that have to be memorized, then I've got something for you. I put together a starter kit for building math fluency in elementary school. And you can just go to buildmathminds.com/starterkit and I'll send it to your email. So I hope that this video has helped you build your math mind so you can build the math minds of your kiddos. And don't forget, if you want that starter kit, it's buildmathminds.com/starterkit. Have a great day.